Control over depth of field is probably the most critical camera tool that you have. You can make the background blurry or sharp depending on what you want in your frame. For example, when you're shooting subjects or people, you may want the background blurry, but while you're shooting landscapes, architecture, or buildings, you may want the entire frame to be sharp right from the foreground, midground, up to the background. Therefore, the choice of what kind of depth of field that you want depends upon you and your creativity and your desire to make a photograph in a certain way. Now, Mr. Desikan Krishnan is going to show us some examples of his photographs which demonstrate shallow depth of field.
Now, I'm going to show you some examples where I deliberately threw the background out of focus. I wanted shallow depth of field, so I deliberately threw the background out of focus either by opening up my aperture or using a long focal length or getting as close as possible to the person or to the subject or all three factors in combination. Let's have a look at those pictures. Here it is, photograph of a child. I just wanted the child in focus. I didn't want the background anything. I wanted the background to be completely out of focus. So I was shooting this, let's say, with the 80 to 200 mm zoom. I zoomed in at 200, went as close as possible to the child and shot at 2.8, which was an open aperture. So the background went completely out of focus. The next picture, the child and his relative. Now, if you see the background now, it's getting some detail. I wouldn't say it is sharp, but compared this to the previous one, it was all shot in the same place. Here the background has gone completely out of focus. Here it has come in. Why? Because I had to zoom out from 200 mm. I had to come down to 150 to accommodate both the man and the child, and I had to move backwards also. So the background has got a little amount of detail because I had on two variations, I had come back, I've increased my camera to subject distance, and I've also gone to a shorter focal length. The other photograph over here is of the grandfather and the grandchild. Have a close look at it. There is a grandfather clock behind, which has gone completely out of focus. I wanted it out of focus. I shot at 2.8 open aperture. It was indoors. I wanted the clock. I wanted the curtain in the background also out of focus. I didn't want depth of field over here. I wanted to reduce my depth of field to the maximum extent possible, and I achieved it. The clock, you could see the shape of the clock, but it is completely out of focus. The curtain there is also out of focus. Just the child and its grandfather are sharp over here. So you can be creative. You can choose the areas which you want in focus or whether you want it out of focus. Let's have a look at another picture. Here it is. My concentration was only on this lady. I wanted to create an atmosphere of a field, of a paddy field. I wanted to create an atmosphere of women working over there, but I didn't want detail on the other women. I wanted sharpness and clarity only on this woman. So what did I do? I went as close as possible. I had a lens and I opened up my aperture. I opened up my aperture so that the other ladies there have gone out of focus and only this lady was sharp and she stands out. This is the way you get your creative instincts. This is the way you manipulate. This is the way you can manipulate your depth of field. Let's have a look at another photograph. This was taken at a temple. I just wanted to isolate the boy from the crowd. So I went as close as possible to him. I used a zoom lens, 80 to 200 mm lens at 200, and I also shot at full open aperture, which was 2.8. So the background here has gone completely out of focus. My interest or the focus is only on the boy and his smile. We move on to the next picture, which is a macro, which is a close-up of an insect. So here, obvious, I went very close, opened up my aperture. You get very, very interesting background patterns. Whenever you try and get close to the subject, especially for a portrait, when you get very close to the subject and you open up the aperture and go to your full zoom, you will get very interesting background patterns like this. This was in a garden where I've thrown the leaves and other things over there completely out of focus by opening up my aperture and getting as close as possible to the subject. Next one, the same this thing where just the insect is sharp. Now just imagine, supposing if I had shot this at f16 or f22, now my picture would have been cluttered up. The background would have come in focus, the leaves and the dry leaves, the wet leaves, whatever it is, all of them would have been in focus, and it would have taken away the attention from that insect climbing that twig. So that is the reason where I opened up my aperture. I wanted to throw the background completely out of focus. The only thing we have to remember when you're opening up the aperture, when you're working with open apertures, your focus has got to be absolutely accurate, because it does not have any depth of field. Okay, so your focus will have to be on the dot so that you create effects like this. This is another picture of an insect. Again, the same thing. I opened up my aperture, went as close as possible because I was sure that the leaves and the other trees in the background would confuse the subject. I wanted the subject to stand out against the background, and this is how I achieved it. All this is possible. You don't have to have very sophisticated equipment to get it. Your own kit lens, your own Mac kit lens which you have, you would be able to do this even in your own kit lens. Probably you will get a slightly bigger figure which you can crop. Here is a flower where I wanted the green leaves, the green is from the leaves and the foliage in the background. The flower stands out because of open aperture, fully open apertures. Another insect picture, the same principle holds good. I don't have to go into explanation, just have a close look at the picture. Two lilies, water lilies. That's the water over there, which has gone completely out of focus. It creates such an interesting pattern. The out of focus water over there and the leaves floating creates such an interesting pattern in the background. Here it is, another one. Close up of the flower. This was deliberately done. I was shooting for a book cover where I wanted focus only on this. This was an illustration where the text could go in. The text could go in the out of focus area. I have the pillar there, one pillar which is very sharp. The rest of the area could be used for superimposing the text. So this was very deliberately done, put it on this thing, opened up my aperture fully so that I could get space over there. And this is how you create pictures for a design. This was for a book cover design, and they wanted something like this. They wanted some picture, they wanted text to be written on top of this. So this is what was done.
Now that you have learnt about and seen examples of shallow depth of field, I hope that you will step out and experiment and make some interesting and creative shots using shallow depth of field. Do try to take some portraits of people close to you in your family, in your locality, and try and experiment with the shallow depth of field. It is only through practice that you will master any concept.
Thank you.